Let's taste that pandi curry with the kadam buttu. That's a classic combination. That's delicious. So this, I think, is a typical home style sort of a vegetable curry. The sort that your grandma would make for you if you were blessed to be born in a Kodava house. That pork certainly looks moist. Moist with all that fat.
Fat.
Glisten in that kadai. That fat has its own unique flavor and that jammy, slightly sticky sort of a texture. That pudding melts away in the warmth of your mouth, and the flavors of this pudding finds its way into every crevice in your mouth. Hi folks, this is Kripal Amana, Gourmet on the Road, and you're watching Food Lovers TV. So today we've stepped out to taste some Kodava cuisine. Well, for those not in the know, Kodava cuisine is the food of the Kodava community who hail from the Kodagu region in Karnataka, also known as Coorg or the Scotland of India. So it's been a while since we've tasted Kodava food in Gourmet on the Road. I think the last time we tasted Kodava food was when we were in Mysuru and we visited this restaurant called Simply Kodavas. If you haven't caught that episode yet, I'm going to place a link here and also in the description below. So we've heard of this restaurant in East Bengaluru called the Coorg Food Company, run by a Kodava couple, serving up dishes from their culinary traditions. So needless to say, I'm looking forward to savoring this Kodava meal. Well, this seems like you're entering somebody's home with the paddy from the harvest.
Hi.
How are you doing? Namaste.
Good. Welcome to Coorg Food Company.
Thank you very much. So I'm with Pavit Ponnappa and Pavita Poonacha, the couple behind the Coorg Food Company.
We were missing our grandmother's food so much, so we wanted to preserve the flavors that we were used to during our summer holidays.
Okay.
You know, that's when we started looking around and getting all the old recipes.
Okay.
And all our aunts who are now getting a little older. So getting all their wonderful recipes that we were used to when we were kids.
Mm-hmm.
So those recipes we bought together and also refined them by visiting certain remote corners of Coorg and making it as authentic as possible.
So these are recipes that come from the family?
From the family.
Yes, all right.
Yeah,
yes.
Very old flavors where we grow our own spices, crush our own masalas, and you know, as detailed as that.
So do you have estates back in Coorg?
Back in Coorg.
Yeah. All right. So a lot of the produce that probably goes into
almost
the
all of them, yeah.
Comes from your estate?
From the estate.
Oh, okay.
So,
and the food here is Kodava food?
Kodava food.
Authentic Kodava food.
Authentic Kodava food.
Not Coorg cuisine. There
okay.
is nothing called Coorg cuisine. This Coorg has a lot of communities and this is Kodava. This cuisine belongs to the Kodavas. So you have the Gowdas also from Coorg. They have pandi curry, but they'll have a different pandi curry. It won't be the same as this.
Oh.
So there's a huge difference between Kodava cuisine and Coorg cuisine generically.
No. So I think any Kodava celebration, the pandi curry is a must.
Yes.
Of course,
right?
Of course. So if you don't get your pandi curry right, then you don't have a Kodava restaurant.
Ah.
It has to be perfect.
So if you want to judge a Kodava restaurant, you got to taste that pandi curry first.
Pandi curry.
With the karta masala.
With the karta masala.
And kacham puli, don't forget.
And the kacham puli vinegar.
Yes.
Again, this vinegar is harvested back in US.
Back in Coorg.
So these are trees that grow wild.
Wild.
Similarly, our chilies that we use is bird's eye chili, which is not harvested, but it's picked, it's grown in the wild and it's picked from in between the coffee plants.
So the tiny, you call them the paringe.
Paringe.
Paringe,
paringe in the local
paringe modu.
Language.
So all these ingredients come from your estate?
From our estate. Like even for a pepper chicken, the pepper is so important that it comes from Coorg because of the heat that the peppers from Coorg has compared to what's available in the local market.
All right.
That makes all the difference in our dishes. For our dishes, we definitely need Malabar shade-grown pepper.
Wow.
Without it, it doesn't work.
What about the rice?
We get it from Coorg, BKB rice, which is also invented in Coorg.
Really?
Yeah, okay. By the family in Coorg.
So what's that rice all about? Is it like a short grain, long grain?
It's a short grain.
Okay.
It's a short grain, but it has more flavor.
Oh.
Which is used more mainly for our string hopper, which is noon puttu, our rice cakes, which is paputu, or the dumplings, which are kadambudus.
So you've had this restaurant now for 6 years.
Yes. 6 years.
The place also has a very cozy, homey sort of a feel.
Yes.
So if you see the benches that we have, these are how we sat in our grandmother's house. There was nothing. All the kids always ate first.
Okay.
And we were all put in benches like this.
Okay.
And it was a riot when the kids got together. And of course, chairs like this also was very popular during those days in the 70s and 80s.
That's right. The folding chairs, the metal chairs.
Yeah. So we kept these alive. Like that's called the Nari Mangala.
Nari Mangala.
Yeah, that is marrying the soul of the tiger to the person who's hunted it. Because in the early days, we were all agriculturists.
Okay.
So tigers were more of an intrusion.
Okay.
So then if this tiger was a man-eater and it was too much trouble in the village, then one person would cull it. And it was a big occasion. So if you've seen the picture also, you have the Britishers and you have the local people.
That's right.
Attending this function.
And then of course that's the traditional Kodava
Odikati, yeah. And that whole silver belt is called a Todanga. This is unpasteurized forest honey.
Oh, lovely. I see that you also selling some pork pickle.
Yeah. Pork pickle, prawn pickle and bamboo shoot pickle.
And all this is made in house.
Made in house, including the masalas for it. And these are again family recipes.
So food is an integral part of every Kodava celebration,
yes.
Right?
Yes. Alcohol and the meat.
The alcohol and the meat. Of course, out here today, we're going to focus only
on
the food and more specifically on some of the meat as well. But I'm told you also do a lot of vegetarian dishes.
Of course, of course. During the monsoons, you have the most popular one is bamboo shoot, which is bamble curry. Then you have kumu curry, which is mushrooms.
Wild mushrooms.
Then you have terme topu.
Ferns.
Which is ferns,
ferns okay.
Fiddlehead,
yeah.
Exclusively
and we also
eaten
have
during
the wild mango curry, which wild you can mango. Get from the forest.
Which I'm seeing on the menu
yes.
here today.
Yes.
So speaking of all the food, can we get into the kitchen
sure,
and see
sure.
what's
sure,
cooking?
Come.
Let's get into the kitchen here at the Kurk Food Company. Let's go. Well, I can already smell the
aroma.
The aroma of that roasted masala.
So we will be making something called the Pandi Bartad.
Pandi Bartad.
Yes, the traditional pork fry.
All right.
So this is the black masala which coriander, cloves, cinnamon, jeera have all been individually roasted on a low flame.
Okay.
And then they're powdered into a fine karta masala.
So this karta masala almost looks like coffee.
Yes.
Coffee powder,
yes.
Right? So even if you look at the roast, this is like a deep roasted
deep
coffee
roast.
Bean. That's
deep,
the color.
Yes. And this is the kacham puli which we will be adding into the pork fry.
No kacham puli, no authentic Kodava.
No, you will
dish.
Not get the taste of the pork at all. In a pork dish or mainly most of the dishes, instead of using synthetic vinegar, instead of using lime, the souring agent is the
kacham puli. So the kacham puli
is a tenderizer.
Also is a tenderizer.
Yes, a meat tenderizer.
So do you also use this when you marinate meat?
We do.
You do?
We do. A big piece of meat, like not the shredded ones or the pieces.
That certainly smells quite acidic, quite
very
sharp.
Acidic, very acidic.
So basically you only need a little bit.
Very little.
Yes.
Very, just a teaspoon.
If you're cooking a kilo of meat.
A kilo of meat, 2 teaspoons is more than enough.
That's all that you need.
Yes.
And this is.
Yeah, sometimes it's, if it's very strong, even 1 teaspoon is enough.
So this is basically the tree, the kacham puli tree.
Kacham puli tree.
So you gather the berries.
And they use it in the estate to, to release the liquid.
Fantastic. So you have the karta masala and you have the kacham puli, that is the heart.
Yes, the main ingredient.
The main ingredient.
For the pork fry. We're going to be making the pandi bartada, traditional pandi bartada with the karta masala.
Okay.
And these are boneless pork meat, which has the meat and fat.
There's always fat
marinated.
That's kind of used in most of the Kodava dishes.
Yes. So we don't use that much oil in our pork dishes.
So it's the fat.
It's fat which actually gives the flavor, adds the flavor to it.
And this is marinated.
This is marinated. This is very simple marination with turmeric, paringamalu and a little bit of salt.
Paringamalu, that's the bird eye chili.
Bird's eye chili.
And that's what you have here.
Yes, this is the one.
So you can't really touch this chili with your hands.
No, you can, but then you know what, if by mistake you touch your eyes with that, it's very pungent and it's very strong, it'll burn your eyes.
So when you see a small chili like this, harmless though it may look, it certainly isn't. It's the sort of chili that can singe you on the inside.
Yes. That's pork fat that we use.
That's pork fat?
Yes, not oil.
Oh, okay. So where do you get pork fat from?
From the cooking of the pork.
Okay.
Which is pressure cooked. A lot of fat releases. So we remove that fat and we store it. It's a very cooling agent.
Okay.
Pork fat is very cooling for the body.
Alright.
So it's even better than refined oil. So
okay.
If you're using pork fat along with the pork dish, the flavor enhances.
Oh, fantastic.
In that. So a little bit of mustard.
Mustard.
Yeah. Along with some curry leaves.
I think when it comes to this part of the country, curry leaf always is a big part of most dishes.
Part. So it's a simple fry.
Okay.
Once it's fried, pork needs to be pressure cooked.
So this is raw pork, right?
Raw pork.
Raw marinade. How long did you marinate this?
Overnight.
You marinate this.
So ginger garlic paste.
Ginger garlic paste.
So now we'll be adding the katta masala. So we let this cook until the masalas get into the meat.
So that's going to cook for about 30 minutes.
Yes, 30 minutes.
And then it will be pressure cooked. How long
and
will it be pressure cooked?
For about a whistle.
So they have a batch that's already been through the process, that's cooked for about 30 minutes, that's been pressure cooked.
Yes.
For about a whistle. And that's what emerges at the end of it.
Yes.
So have you put kachampuli in this already?
Already there.
Okay, so
yes.
When do you put
by
the kachampuli?
When you're putting it in the cooker to pressure cook it, that's when we put the
kachampuli. That's when you add the kachampuli.
Yes.
So that's the reason why the color has...
Correct. With the katta masala, it's become a little more darker now because of the kachampuli. So this will be really tasty and it just melts in your mouth. It's
lovely.
So soft.
Some
coriander to finish it off.
But that pork certainly looks moist. Moist with all that fat.
Fat.
Glisten in that kadai.
Pork fry is ready to be served.
Ready to be served.
Yes.
I think on that note, let's head out to the restaurant and taste that pork bartudu and also some of the other dishes that make the food here at the Koor Company special. Let's go. You know, I like the coziness of this place. It's not a very big space. It's a small space, but it's tastefully done. I think the cement floors, the wood paneling, and some of the other elements that you see around, the photo frames, and this lovely window here, which brings in a bit of the green. I'm told they call it the Madikeri window, because in Koor, every home will have windows that will look out onto the green. And that's the inspiration for the Madikeri window right here. The mask goes away in anticipation of the food that will troop out from the kitchen shortly. Passion fruit juice. Oh, fantastic. Stir it up and muddle some of the mint into the glass along with the orange. That's a refreshing drink. I was expecting the passion fruit to be a bit tart. You have some sourness, but I think it's balanced with some sweetness that perhaps is there in the passion fruit puree. And this, I'm told, again comes from the estate. So almost all the ingredients that go into the food here come from Pavit and Pavita's estate back in Koor. I can also taste a slight bitter edge from that orange rind. Well, we have our appetizers here at the Koor Food Company, and for all the talk of pork, we're beginning with some vegetarian appetizers. So what we have here is the lady's finger fry, the bindi fry, and then you also have a vegetable cutlet. I'm told they do seasonal cutlets, and the one cutlet that I definitely am going to return for is the chekke cutlet or the jackfruit cutlet. The jackfruit is not in season now, so we have a vegetable cutlet, and then you have a bitter gourd fry. This is a dish that I'm looking forward to tasting, because bitter gourd is not everyone's favorite, not mine too, but I'm told in this dish you can't taste the bitterness of that bitter gourd. And then we have some non-vegetarian appetizers here. This is the koli bartudu, the pepper fry, the chicken, and then you have the keema unde. But this is the keema unde done Kodowa style. I'm told there's more of the meat that you taste in that. There's hardly any binder. There's no binder at all. It's only the meat. And then, of course, you have the pork. So that's the onakerichi, which is the smoked pork. And then you have the pork bartudu, the pandi bartudu, with the karta masala, with the kachampuli, and that explains for the dark color of that pandi bartudu. And then this is an interesting dish, a dish that I've never tasted before. This, I'm told, is called the Tittapandi, which literally translates to fire poke. And the fire in this comes from that bird eye chili or the Paringamolu, which they use in cooking in the Kodagu region. I think let's begin with something tame. We begin with the vegetables. So I'm going to begin with the bhindi. While we are at it, let's also get one of the cutlets. The bhindi is crispy. So you've got julienes of lady fingers coated in a rice flour batter with minimal seasoning. Maybe some kala namak, maybe some chaat masala. And that's literally all that you taste. And once you get past that rice flour batter, you can bite into that slight pulpiness of the lady's finger. A chatpata beginning to my tasting here. Let's go next for that vegetable cutlet. There's some sweetness that I taste in this cutlet that perhaps comes from the onion. It certainly makes for a tasty bite. You have the soft crunch of the crust and then you bite into that vegetable mash. So I'm told there's some carrots in there, some potatoes, maybe some beans as well. But what you really taste is the savouriness of the onions. There's some fried onions that have probably gone into the making of this vegetable cutlet. Certainly it's a tasty cutlet. You have some mint chutney here, but I don't think you really need any of that. This cutlet is flavoursome on its own. I love the slightly sweet savouriness of the fried onions in that cutlet. Certainly gives that cutlet a bit of a lift. But next we're going to taste the bitter gourd fry. So the bitter gourd is not everyone's favorite vegetable. It isn't mine as well, because honestly I find the bitterness a bit off-putting. But out here they've fried the bitter gourd, and then the bitter gourd is tossed along with some onions, some chili powder, I think there's some coriander. So it's almost like a fried bitter gourd that is assembled together in a fresh salad of sorts, an onion-based salad. I think there's definitely a lot of lemon that's gone in to balance the bitterness. The kaipe. I think the kaipe is bitter. Kai is vegetable or fruit, and that's why the kaipe kai, the bitter gourd. So there's certainly plenty of lemon that's gone in that's balancing against the bitterness of that kaipe kai. And then you also are tasting some of the green chili and the moist crunch of the onions. So the bitter gourd, by virtue of being deep fried, has lost some of its bitter punch. You still taste the bitterness of the bitter gourd towards the end of the bite. Give me bitter gourd like this, I'll happily eat it every day. Let's proceed quickly to the non-vegetarian side of things. I think when it comes to the Kodavas, I love their meat. So every celebration, every occasion, be it a celebration or a solemn gathering of people coming together, there's always food, and at the heart of food is the meat. I'm quite tempted to move towards the pork, but I think we should taste the chicken before we get to the pork. This is the chicken pepper fry, the Koli Bartad. That's a flavorful chicken. I love the flavor of that masala. With the onion, with that peppery punch, and then that tartness of that kachampuli. And all that masala somehow manages to impregnate that chicken with its flavors, and that's what you're tasting in this Koli Bartad. And then that pepperiness of that fresh cracked pepper. And this is chicken on the bone. Always more flavor when you have chicken on the bone. I think the whole concept of boneless is a bit overrated, especially when it comes to chicken. Or when you'd cook at home traditionally, you'd always have chicken on the bone, and that's where the flavor is. If you remove the bone, there's absolutely no flavor. You could be eating anything. I want to pry some of that meat from this piece and also take in some of that masala. The onions are beautifully braised in that pepper fry. They're braised to the point where they're savory, but there's also a hint of sweet. I was expecting the pork dishes to be the highlight, but that chicken has certainly managed to more than whisper to my palate. And next, let's go to that khaima unde. So I've tasted many a khaima unde, but I haven't tasted a Kodava style khaima unde. It's mostly meat with minimal spicing that's fashioned into these roundels and then shallow fried in ghee. This certainly feels crisp on the outside. So it's crisp out, but on the softer side inside. You know, all that you're tasting in this thai maunde is a flavor of the meat and that ghee that it has been fried in. I'm sure there's some spicing that goes into it. Perhaps some salt, some pepper, maybe some ginger garlic. But that spicing is so minimal that all that you're tasting is the flavor of the meat. And what's interesting is the texture. So you crunch into the meat and then on the inside, you bite into the near juiciness of that unde, of that mutton. And as you work towards the core of this kaima unde, the meat starts getting softer. So it is as much about the flavor of the meat as it is about the texture of the meat when it's shallow fried in that ghee. Chase it with some curry leaves, some karve soppu. That curry leaf disintegrates into a toasty, flavorful powder the moment you bite on it. So let's taste next some onakka erichi. So this is a smoked dried pork. It's the first of the pork dishes that we're going to be tasting at the Coorg Food Company. So this, I'm told, is a traditional dish. In the estates, you'd basically have the meat that was left to cure for days and then that would be shredded and tossed. Tossed with some onions, some chilies, and of course some kachampuli. So some of the strands are meat, and then you have some strands which is pure fat. And that fat almost has a bit of a gummy bite to it as you chew on it. This is the sort of dish that would be great with your evening tipple. That's exactly the sort of dish that this is. As you pick on the meat, a bit of the fat, some onions, and then of course that ever-present edge of that kachampuli. There's also some chili in this dish, but the heat of the chili in this dish is warming. It's not the sort that will seize hold of your palate. And there's a veil of smokiness that you detect in the meat. Not overpowering, but as you bite into the meat, you can certainly detect that faint smokiness. Let's move next to that pandi bartad. And this is the dish that I saw being prepared. Most of the dishes here have the karta masala, which is the deep roasted masala with coriander, with jeera, fenugreek seeds. And that's really the heart of the kodava masala. And towards the end, when the dish is nearly cooked, you have the kachampuli. That kachampuli that brings with it its tart, acidic fervor. You know, the onakka erichi, because of the fact that it is smoked and cured, is a bit chewy. But this pandi bartadu is a sort that breaks down readily as you bite on it and releasing the flavors of that deep roasted karta masala. And I'm told karta means dark, and if you look at this dish is almost as dark as night. I bit into that fat, and that fat has its own unique flavor and that jammy, slightly sticky sort of a texture. Oh, that's delicious. I want to taste now a piece which has both the meat and the fat. You know, the rich, buttery notes of that fat almost mollycoddles that meat. I think I'm going to look for pieces which have both the fat and the meat, because I think that's the tastiest part of this pandi bartad. You want to make sure that you have a piece which with some fat and then the meat as well. That fat has rendered down beautifully as that vartadu is cooked in that pan for 30 or 45 minutes and then cooked further in the pressure cooker and then removed to be tossed again in a pan. I love the deep flavors, that masala, and then all the flavor of the pork, accentuated by the pork fat. That's delicious. And now we're going to go for our last pork appetizer. Well, this is a tasting at a Kodava restaurant, so there will be a lot of pork on the menu. And this, I've learned, is an interesting hunter's dish. So all that you have in this dish is some rock salt and some chili, that Parengamodu chili. And traditionally, this dish would be made with wild boar when hunting was permitted. And so the hunters would carry some chili with them, some salt with them. So they would hunt down the animal and then cook it with just the chili and the salt. And that's the inspiration for this Tittu Pandi. Tittu means fire, the fiery heat of that Parengamodu chili. And that chili certainly makes its presence felt as you bite on it. So I'm told the meat is marinated in the chili and then it's tossed again with some more chili that's added to that meat, which certainly makes it a spice bomb of a pork dish. You know, I've tasted, it's quite a spicy preparation. I've tasted three pork dishes, from the Onakka Erichi to the Pandi Vartadu and the Tittu Pandi. But all three are uniquely different. In the Onakka Erichi, you taste the smokiness of the meat. The meat is a bit chewy because after all the meat is smoked. But when it comes to that Pandi Vartadu, the meat and the fat is a sort that literally almost dissolves in your mouth. And then you have that fiery heat of the Parengamodu in that Tittu Pandi. Three dishes, unique in character, but all delicious in their own way. I definitely need some of the cooling that will come from this buttermilk after that Tittu Pandi. I can still taste the heat of the Parengamodu on my tongue and also somewhere on my throat. Definitely taste the coriander. I think there's some Kala Namak, some black salt.
So this is the puttu platter.
Okay.
Nool puttu, which is the string hoppers. Here you have the kadam puttu, which is the rice dumpling.
Rice dumpling.
And the rice cakes, which is the paputu. And then here we have the ghee rice, which has the caramelized onions with some cashews and raisins. This is a coconut-based chicken curry.
Okay.
Here we have the vegetable kootu curry.
Kootu curry.
Here we have the vattis.
And then of course, where would a Kodava meal be without that dark pandi curry? What's interesting here is the fact that they also have the option of serving you in these combo bowls. So basically, these combo bowls, you order for one person. So if there are two or three of you, maybe you can order more dishes and taste them. And I thought the meat platters that I tasted, that pork platter too, was a great idea, where you can come in and you can taste a few things. You're not restricted to one or two dishes because the portions are large and you can't finish it. So out here, we've ordered for everything in the combo portions, at least as far as the main courses go. I think I'm going to begin with that Akki Otti. Or the rice roti. I love the faint toasted aroma of that Akki Otti. I think I'm going to make a beginning with that kootu curry. So some potatoes here, carrots, beans. So this I think is a typical home style sort of a vegetable curry. The sort that your grandma would make for you if you were blessed to be born in a Kodava house. I'm certainly happy to be tasting some Kodava food here. Let's go for that kootu curry. The curry is hot. That's a tasty curry. Gentle, warming. So I think there's some lentils that go into that curry. So that lentil also gives this curry a bit of a powdery creaminess. It's a simple, wholesome vegetable curry. That's pretty much what this kootu curry is all about. So along with the potatoes, the carrots and the beans, you also have some saute kaya, some mangalore cucumber. And then next, we're going to taste some of that traditional koli curry. There's a toastiness to that Akki Otti that wafts through your palate the moment you place it in your mouth. And that's quite pleasing. And I think that toastiness comes from the charred speckles on this Akki Otti. Let's taste that akioti now with that chicken curry. A coconut milk that goes into that chicken curry and some of the other spices, perhaps some coriander, maybe some fenugreek as well. But the masalas are gentle, the masalas are calming. Unlike the bold, vivacious flavors, for some of those appetizers, the pandi bhartada, the onaka erichi, or that fire pandi or the titta pandi, these curries are more calming. And I think that's what you really need after savoring those flavor bombs of appetizers. I think before I go for the puttus, I want to taste the akki oti with some of that pandi curry. This pandi curry looks dark and decadent, stained with the karta masala. Karta means black, and this is a pandi curry that certainly is as dark as night. That pandi curry breaks down the moment you place it in your mouth and gently bite on it. And all that fat has rendered beautifully into that gravy. You know, all that fat almost makes your lips smack. That's how rich this pandi curry is. And the depth of flavor that comes from that masala. Taste a piece with some fat too. That fat breaks down on your palate and releases that rich, almost smoky, unctuous flavor. This is certainly the sort of pandi curry that you want to spend time with. And speaking of time, the good thing about a pandi curry is that it matures with each passing hour. So the best pandi curry is perhaps the pandi curry that was cooked yesterday, if not the day before. It allows for the flavors of that masala, the flavors of that kachampuli to mature and sink into that meat. You know, when it comes to Kodava food, there aren't too many ingredients. The food's fairly simple, fairly straightforward. I think pretty much like Kodava folk, but there is so much depth of flavor and character to each one of the dishes that you taste. I think I'll make a beginning with the noodle puttu and perhaps some of that chicken curry. You want to let that gravy seep into your noodle puttu. Basically, the puttu that's fashioned into these strands. And that, by the way, is an ancient noodle puttu maker. So I guess the rice mix would go on top and it would be pressed and you would have the noodle puttu emerge from the bottom of that contraption. I think I need some more gravy. You want that noodle puttu to soak up all that gravy, literally to the point where it almost disintegrates. To make for those slurp-worthy mouthfuls. I love the creamy, coconutty flavor of that chicken curry and the gentle spicing of the masala. I think I'm going to go for one of the kadam puttu next and taste it with the pandi curry. So basically the rice is ground to a paste to make that kadam puttu. Whereas if you look at the pa puttu, the rice there is more coarser in its texture. So it's the same rice but fashioned into different forms. Let's taste that pandi curry with the kadam puttu. It's a classic combination. That's delicious. I'm going to get some of that gravy, that masala glistening with all that pork fat and particles of the meat that have broken down into that masala as it was being cooked. You know, the spicing here looks dark, looks bold, in fact looks almost too aggressive. And combined with the kachampuli, you may think that one would taste the flavor of the meat. But nah, none of that. The masala and that kachampuli only goes to complement the flavor of the meat and the fat, which is what you taste in every bite of that pandi curry. And the perfect piece of meat is the one that also has some fat clinging onto it. That fat almost dissolves on your palate and cocoons the meat and it's unctuous, fatty embrace. So next we're going to taste the nehi khud, the ghee rice. I can see some cloves in there that have gone in to lend some aroma to that ghee rice. And you can see some of that ghee glisten away. And that fried onion, some cashew, godambi, and some raisins as well. Now this is going to be an interesting rice, rich with that ghee, to savor with the fatty richness of that pandi curry. Taste that nehi khud first just by itself. You can certainly taste the flavor of the cloves, and there's also some garlic, some whole garlic that goes into this. Wow, that's not something that I was expecting to find in this ghee rice. And I think that goes along with the fried onions and the nuts and the raisins that sauteed along with that and then introduced with the ghee to that rice and then tossed up to make for that nehi khud. You know, these are new words to me. So for all you Kodavas who may be watching this, if I mess up some of the pronunciation, please forgive me. Let's taste that pandi curry with that ghee rice. You taste the buttery ghee notes of that rice, and of course that deep roasted flavors of that pandi curry, and then somewhere in the midst of all that you taste the sweet pop of the raisins and the caramelized notes of that onion. And if you're lucky, you'll also bite into a garlic clove that will further release its pungent sweet flavor. I think that garlic is such a lovely addition to that ghee rice. You know, what's interesting about a pandi curry also is that tart edge that you taste. You taste that fat and all that richness that it brings, but then you taste that sharpness of that kachanpuli. And I think that acidity helps cut down the fat, allowing you to go for more of that pandi curry. When it comes to traditional food, every ingredient in a dish has a purpose to serve, and which is also the reason why I can never tire of exploring traditional Indian food like this Kodava meal here. I think I'm going to go for some of that paaputtu. You can definitely taste the texture of this paaputtu. It's broken rice here as opposed to the fine rice particles that went into that pasty kadambuttu. And I think we will close with the kootu curry. Drench the paaputtu with that curry. That comforting vegetable curry now has an added dimension. The crunch of the coconut, that's the garnish on the paaputtu. Oh my goodness. Four decadent desserts. After a meal like that, I typically wouldn't be ordering even one, but then we have to taste what we have to taste. Oh, that's a hot gasgase paisa, a poppy seed paisa. I think if you have this tumbler, it's a sort of paisa that will lull you to sleep. That's what poppy seed does. And then you have the lazy daisy, that's what they call it. So this is basically a sponge cake that's topped with coconut brown sugar. And as if that decadence wasn't enough, there's also some caramel that goes onto it. And this, I'm told, is another one of their signature desserts. This is a tender coconut pudding. And then of course, where would a Kodava meal be without some coffee? This chocolate mousse is laced with coffee from the estate of Pavit and Pavita. So I think we're going to make a beginning with that tender coconut pudding. That pudding melts away in the warmth of your mouth, and the flavors of this pudding finds its way into every crevice in your mouth. And you're tasting the gentle bite of some tender coconut. There's also some milk that's gone into it. You can definitely taste it. But the likeness of this dessert is something else. Visualize tender coconut, and if that was converted into a pudding, that's exactly what it would taste like. That's definitely a dessert that you must close your meal when you're here at the Cool Food Company. I think next we're going to move on to that gasgase paisa. The toasty nuttiness of that gasgase and some milk, and some toasted cashew and raisins thrown in for good measure. This is a dessert that needs no spoon. It's also the dessert that will lull you into a deep siesta, especially after the sort of heavy meal that I've had. I think let's taste that cake. That sponge cake. The coconut and the brown sugar and the caramel on top of that sponge has congealed into toffee. And that toffee is weighing down the sponge with its sweet decadence. So if you like a decadent end to your meal, definitely the Lazy Daisy is a dessert to try. Time to taste the last dessert, and this is the coffee chocolate mousse. So that's a thick mousse, it's quite dense. So I think that's a milk chocolate in there, but then you have the bitterness of the coffee that you also taste through the chocolate. Four ways to end your meal on a sweet note here. But my vote goes to that tender coconut pudding. The lusciousness of creamy tender coconut in a shot glass. Some jaggery coffee to close our meal. Well, I've thoroughly enjoyed our outing to the Coorg Food Company. You know, it's a sort of experience that you would savor if you were visiting a Kodava home in Coorg. Right from the atmosphere in this dining room to the warmth and hospitality of Pavit and Pavita. And not to forget all the delicious dishes that we've tasted that go back to recipes that come from their family. Each one of the dishes that we've tasted has been unique, has been special, cooked with love, has been the sort of dish that leaves behind an impression on your mind and also on your palate. These are certainly dishes that one would return for. I hope you've enjoyed this episode of Gourmet on the Road. Until the next one, stay safe, stay very, very safe, and happy eating. If you'd like to support the work that we do at Food Lovers TV, do consider joining our membership community on YouTube by hitting the join button below or on the homepage. You could pledge a nominal sum and receive special privileges like behind the scenes footage, shoot updates, access to live Q&As, and a lot more. You could support us on a Patreon page as well. For more info, check out the links in the description below. If you like this video, don't forget to subscribe, like, share, and leave a comment below. Happy eating!